We're not actors or TV personalities. We're just a couple of guys who want to show you how to restore your car. Sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we consult the pros. It's never a problem. It's always a project.
This week on Autorestomod, Vinny bumps Jeff. Jeff tells Vinny to watch for finger while the lads put safety first, fix the horn, and replace the steering wheel that smells like vomit. Ew.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend?
And I got a hot deal, too.
You think? Think again.
Oh man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll free.
Doing, man? You could have run over me. You hit me with the car. You hit me.
I didn't hit you. I just nudged you a little to get your attention.
That was not a nudge.
It was a little nudge. I had to get the car in here so we could get to work, and I just had to get your attention to get you out of the way.
You could have used the horn, you know.
I tried to use the horn, but look at this thing. I hit it and hit it and hit it and hit it and there. It didn't work.
They used windshield caulk on this to hold the horn. What kind of car did you buy?
The fixer.
I don't think that's the F word I'd be looking for with this car.
And there's no horn things in here.
Look, we've got the stuff to do it. Let's just go ahead and get this thing back safe and put a steering wheel that doesn't smell like somebody threw up on it. You know, the nice thing is with a lot of the old stuff that's out there now, you've got a lot of parts available. The Mustang's a prime example of this, and the Camaro. And even the Chevelle. There's a lot of parts available to fix up the horn assemblies on these cars, and in all honesty, this should be done. This is kind of a safety measure on the car. It's supposed to be there, so we're going to go over now a lot of the stuff that you're going to need in order to make this happen. Basically, everything that's here is from National Parts Depot, and all of these items are necessary parts for setting up a horn assembly on a vintage car. Basically, you've got a horn spring here in the center. You've got the two horns here on the outside, and you've got a turn signal switch, which on the turn signal switch, you actually have the contacts for the horn itself. Now, if this section here is snapped off or broken, these are laying inside the horn, this can actually cause a problem with the potential for fire. Vince and Gina have already had the problem with the 65 Mustang with something to do with these contacts somewhere inside that hideous steering wheel we've already talked about. You're going to need some stuff in order to make that work, and that's the tools that are here on the table. Now, we've got a meter here that we're going to use to go in and make sure we've got good continuity with our wires. We've got a wire separator for when we want to go in and take the turn signal assembly apart and basically use these pinouts to make it stock again rather than having to go in and cut the wires like you used to have to do. We've also got a steering wheel removal tool, and we've got some leads here so that we can extend our meter if we so choose. Now, Vinny's going to talk to you a little bit about what you can do with steering wheels. So, Vinny, what you got on the table there?
Well, right here on the table, National Parts Depot stocks the original style steering wheel. They also stock the deluxe style steering wheel. And that's just an easy get on the internet. You can order it and have it. And there's a plethora of aftermarket steering wheels available for these cars also. Really cool time to be fixing up a car.
Yeah, that's true. And the nice thing about it is it's not just Mustang. I mean, that's what we're working on today. But in all honesty, a lot of these same parts are available for these cars. So if you wanted to do an aftermarket wheel that was the optional wheel on the Camaro or the Chevelle, they're available from places like National Parts Depot. So I guess that leaves us only one thing, Vinny.
Got to get to it.
Got to get to work. All right, let's do it.
Well, as you can see on the table, we have two horns. These were the original factory horns. Then we have two reproduction horns that we got from NPD. And we've got a little power hooked up so we can give them a test. The negative just goes to anywhere on the frame of the horn, and the positive has to go to the little tab. You have two different tones, and the reproduction horns are almost identical in tone. But they're a little louder. Now, you may have noticed that this one didn't sound quite right. Now, sometimes during shipping, this one set screw gets a little bit loose, and you may need to tighten that up just a little bit at a time until you get the tone right for the horn. Yep, that's better. Once you have it set where you like it, little thread lock, and just so it'll stay in place once it's on the car. So for anybody who's ever been curious on how a horn actually works, we have an old one here that we can take apart. So as you can see, we've got the innards of the horn. We got the little vibrator here.
Vibrator?
Yeah, we've got the vibrator here. So what's happening is when you energize this tab, that voltage is going to a coil inside this assembly that's pulling this down. And you can see how there's a little lip on there. So when it gets pulled down, you're actually opening this contact.
That's pretty substantially sprung, I think.
Pretty substantially sprung. Now, so as that gets pulled down, it opens that contact and then the voltage is broken. So that spring actually pushes it back closed and then it opens again and it just keeps repeating that. And that's how you get your tone on the horn. And then you have this piece that looks kind of like an air horn, like maybe a saxophone, that's just acting like a little megaphone to make the sound come out.
That's really simple, actually.
It is.
I tell you what, though, you know, one of the things that I wanted to bring up on this is on these horn sets, I have taken these and restored them back when you couldn't get these. Back in the day, when these weren't available.
There was no internet.
There was no internet either. Unbelievably, I know. Back in the day with these, you could not actually get the horns. So you'd have to take them and restore them, get them off of another car. And a lot of times if these cars sit for a while, especially in the Southeast, you'll get what we have down here called dirt daubers.
Or bees.
Yeah, the bees aren't typically the bigger problem. They just blow right out the end of it. But the dirt dauber nets will get dirt up inside the megaphone section of this. And I've actually gone in and whacked on the horn to get, and they'll actually start working again. You whack on the horn, you get all the dirt out of them, and the sound comes back. So that's something to keep in mind of if you're getting a set of these older ones and you're working with them, you might be able to get them to work again if you tap on the megaphone and try to keep everything so that when you're working these, you're tapping in this section here and you're keeping that down so that the dirt's coming around this way and then you're pouring it out like that. Matter of fact, we just got some dirt out on the table doing that. So that's something to keep in mind of when you're working with the original stuff. But the really cool thing is, you can go down to National Parts Depot and buy a pair of those. Bada bing, you're done.
All right, time to actually put them on the car now. So anytime you're working on the electrical system, disconnect your negative battery. Protect yourself, protect your equipment.
Okay, one of your first orders of business is going to be to remove the actual steering wheel so you can get a look at what's going on inside the turn signal area on here. And one of the things I'll tell you is a lot of times these setups are pretty beat up on the other side of the wheel. So what you'll need to do, at least on a Ford product, is take a 15/16 inch socket and take the nut off. And since this car doesn't have a locking column, sometimes that can be a problem. Get it loose, and you pull this nut off. Now this is a homemade steering wheel puller, but you can buy these at the auto parts store. They're pretty cheap, and I would recommend having one in the box. Installs on here. Uses a fine thread bolt setup. I'm using a half inch bolt. You'll go in, put tension on it. A lot of times you can just turn this and get it to pop loose like that. Now that comes off. All right, here's your first clue you got a problem. This is one of your contacts for your horn assembly, and it's just hanging in the wind here, and that's what was probably causing the power problem that Gene and Vince were having, where they were seeing sparks inside the car whenever they're driving and turning the wheel. This was contacting the back side of the wheel because this is 12 volts on it constant. So that's our sign of a problem. Here's the rest of the piece right here. Now I'll show you what the problem probably was. This actually rides on the center ring, but you've got this outside ring from this horn's just total distortion. This should be concentric. These should be the same distance from each other, and because of heat distortion, this is way blown off one side. So we've got a problem on here that we would have to deal with regardless. We'd have to replace this steering wheel. Even if we were going to refinish a wheel, this would make this a totally unacceptable example. So I guess I'll just give this to Vinny as a memento. All right, Vinny. Here's your steering wheel.
All right, thanks. Dang, this thing does kind of smell like vomit.
Now,
Now, we always stress disconnecting the negative on the battery just for safety anytime you're working on the electrical system. Now, in this case, we want to trace the 12 volts going from the fuse panel over to the horn switch and then actually to the horn. So we're going to go ahead and hook that up for a minute while we do these tests. Now we're ready to go. So what we know right now is that the horn in this car doesn't work. Now, this is our new turn signal switch that includes the two posts for the horn. So before you get started, you're going to need a few things. Suggest having a multimeter. Always suggest having a wiring diagram anytime you're working on an electrical system on your car. These really aren't that expensive and they're well worth the money. So after having consulted the wiring diagram, I know that there should be 12 volts on the post. So I'm going to check for that 12 volts. And sure enough, I don't have 12 volts there. So at this point I need to stop, because if I don't have 12 volts here at the switch, I'm never going to get 12 volts out to the horn. Looking at the wiring diagram, I can see there should be 12 volts on this yellow wire right at the connector. So on top of having your wiring diagrams, you also have your eyes, and sometimes you can trace the wire out. So we trace this one out. Oh, I can see that my yellow wire is disconnected, so I don't have 12 volts. So I connect that back into the wiring harness. Bam, got my 12 volts. Now that I have 12 volts here, strongly recommend getting some test wire leads with the gator clips on the end. These are very helpful. So I can jumper my one post that's in the car now and the wire that should be going to the other post if I had the other post. And now I can check for 12 volts right out at the horn.
All right, now I've got my multimeter here and I'm gonna hook up, and we've got 12 volts. Now basically what you wanna do is you wanna hook up to one of the horn wires, it really doesn't matter which one out here, and check it, we got 12 volts here, so we know that our wiring system on this car is good. Now all we gotta do is go in and hook the horns up, and we're ready to go. Okay, we've got our horns mounted in the car, everything's ready to go. And I wanna talk about this with your horns. Even with the new stuff, grounding is very important, and you'll wanna make sure that you use a bolt that grounds the horn correctly. Now, we like to use these. These are a serrated edge bolt. You'll note that the washer has some sharp serrations in this side of it, and that's so it'll dig into the metal a little bit whenever you're tightening them down and give you a good ground. You can also use these. Now, a lot of the 65, 66 early Mustangs use this, and some of the early Fairlanes too. This type of bolt does the same function. It's just the serrations are more pronounced. Any way you go, grounding is important, because basically, as we've talked about before, the body of the horn grounds to the chassis, and you want to have a good ground in order for good horn operation.
Okay, now that we've finished all those checks, we're going to go ahead and disconnect the negative on the battery while we install the new turn signal switch in the steering wheel. Now, I'm going to go ahead and cut all of these wires coming out of the steering wheel harness. We really try not to do that on original harness pieces, but in this case, we're replacing every single one of these wires, and I'm just going to cut them so I can use them as pulls for the new wires. Okay, now that I have that done, I can go ahead and pull the turn signal switch. Be certain to keep your metal spacer. And be careful now when you're pulling the turn signal switch. You don't want to pull it out too far, or you'll pull your wires that you're going to use as string wires right up into the steering column and make things difficult for yourself. And you don't need to use a ton of tape to tape these wires together. Just enough so you can use the old wires to pull the new wires through the steering column. Because remember, you have to take that tape off once you get the new wires through. Well, that was bad. Okay, so that first set was a little bit too thick to get through the steering column, so I had to run another wire in order to pull a pull string through the steering column. So I'm going to try this again. Now, this time I'm staggering the wires a little bit to make the bundle a little bit thinner as it initially goes into the steering column. And I'm going to be a bit more generous with the electrical tape this time. So now you can see we've got a much more gradual taper as we get to the thicker bundle of wires. And success. This time the wires made it all the way to the bottom of the column. Now, when you put the turn signal switch back in, be careful. That plastic is a little bit fragile. You don't want to twist it too hard or it'll just break. One other thing you want to do before you put the steering wheel back on, you'll want to go ahead and get the horns hooked up. And you can use a jumper cable like this one, just a jumper between the two posts. Verify that the horns work before you put the steering wheel back on so you don't have to pull the steering wheel back off if there is a problem.
All right, got our steering wheel and our horn ring. We're going to set those aside for a second. Now that I've got the horns hooked up in the front, I'm going to take the jumper and connect it to the 12 volt and then to the horns to check function. And since it's about 11 o'clock at night, I'm sure the neighbors are extremely happy with me right now. But at least we know the horn works. Now, one thing you need to make sure you've got on this assembly is this spring here. This spring actually adds tension to the steering wheel. It's really important that you put that on there. Now, since we haven't moved the front end, the steering wheel will go back on pretty much straight in. And we'll need to get our nut and install it. Take your 15/16 and tighten it up. Now, one thing you'll find on the 65 sometimes is a bigger distance between the column and the actual steering wheel. Now, you can actually go in and adjust this distance because the shaft is fixed. All right, now, in order to move the column, you're going to need to take those two brackets underneath here loose, and you're going to need to bring the column up not too tight, but about right there should do you. Okay, and now you need to retighten the bolts underneath. Now, this isn't going to be the case on every column. Only the early Ford solid shaft setups like the 65 Mustang, Fairlane, those kind of cars will have that kind of a setup where you can adjust the column here. Post 66, you're not going to be able to do that. Then you go in and unhook the battery. All right, now you're going to put your horn button on. You've got a spring that goes on the inside here and basically slightly offset. I'm going to be careful because those little plastic tabs in there could possibly break off. Now, we're going to rehook the battery here in a second and give her a try and see what we come up with. All right, we've been fighting this thing for the last several minutes. We tried to put the horn on, make the horn work, didn't want to work. And what you have to be careful of on some of these horn setups is this. If these contacts aren't out and level with each other, you've got a problem. And on this one, what was happening was, is this yellow wire right here was actually contacting the outer rim here and causing that wire to stick. So what we've done is we've moved the wire down so that it's not hard up against this outer casing. And now we feel pretty sure, in theory, that this is gonna work fine. So now I'm gonna put the wheel back on for the 11,200th time. And what we're gonna do here, tighten this up and do a test. We're gonna run our lead from the horn contact here to the ground here, and we've got horns at 11:45 at night. I know my neighbors are gonna love me a lot. There. All right, Vinny, let's hook the battery up and see what we get.
Horn works.
Watch for finger. All right, we got our horn working, so that's great. Basically, all we got to do now is do the rest of the car.